Hello, hello, and welcome to my thought on this very interesting Tuesday. I've been thinking about disability, and I've been thinking about how we bend over backwards to not treat people who are disabled differently, even though we really should, but we try to make life as easy as possible for them. And I'm all for that. But I also have some questions. I remember back in 1980, I had a friend who had polio. Those of you who are so frightened about the virus, you don't know what it was like with polio. There was absolutely no way we knew how we were going to get it, but when we got it, we were crippled for life. So she had polio much earlier. And she was in a wheelchair. And we were talking about her mobility, her difficulty to get somewhere. I wanted to meet her somewhere and her difficulty. And she said to me, she said, "It's you who make me disabled." And I thought, what does she mean? And this was in 1980, when we didn't have sloping curbs at intersections, when phone booths were impossible to get into and you needed a phone booth because you didn't have a mobile phone, when buildings were impossible to get to because you had to climb steps to get there and there was no ramp. And we have come a long way. Computers have done a tremendous amount to keep us from making life miserable for people who are disabled. And I've seen so much improvement, but sometimes I think we tend to go the other way and be almost too overzealous in creating safe spaces for people who are disabled. And I'm reminded of my friend Allison in Scotland, who was saying that they had a huge collection in school for the primary school that she was sending her child to, because they needed to build an elevator to go from the first floor to the second floor. And they were doing it for one child. And what she said to me is, couldn't somebody just carry that kid up the stairs? I don't know. I think that it's terribly important for somebody who is not as able, whose faculties, who have some faculties that hamper them in moving through society, I think it's important for them to be able, independent and to be able to take that elevator, not have to rely on someone carrying them up the steps. I believe that. I believe that. I'm remembering a young man who was a thalamite baby. I'm not pronouncing that right. And I was at an open mic at Martuni's in San Francisco, which is an absolutely wonderful place if you haven't tried it. And I hope they're open. And they have a lovely grand piano. And we all go there. We used to go there to sing. And this young man came in who had no arms, no hands. And I thought, now, how's he going to sing? And he managed with his elbow to turn on the computer. And he sang the most beautiful voice. I still remember, and I get goosebumps thinking about how beautiful his voice was. The thing that I'm wondering is to what degree we make people disabled. And of course, part of my interest will always be in what we do to hamper the aged when we think we're helping them. And one of the things that this pandemic has brought home is how harmful these overzealous, overprotective practices are for the aged, how very harmful they are. If you recall, and it's still happening, that in old age homes, they are putting people in their rooms and they're putting food through the door. So these people who are not too adept, if they are adept at the computer, they are not suffering, except that they need exercise. But if they are not, and very many of them, many more than you believe, are not adept at the computer, I'm still shocked. In my building, there are 66 people living here, and this Oxford professor is not a, he doesn't have a computer, and he doesn't have a television set. I can't imagine that. And he comes down to the main recreation room to watch television. And of course he tells me he has nothing to do. Of course he doesn't, because he doesn't have the computer as I do. So if you remember, they were shoving people in their rooms and literally locking them in. And the only thing they have, their only connection with human connection, is the computer. If they know how to use Zoom, and if they know how to use FaceTime, and if they know how to use Skype, all of which are much bigger ifs than those of us who are adept at the computer realize, then they're in connection. But we are social animals. If you don't believe how important that is, remember the story of the babies in Romania. And this was back in the 50s, so of course none of you remember it but me. But back in the 50s, the Romanian orphanages packed children so tightly into these little rooms and gave them absolutely no, they didn't touch them. They fed them, they kept them warm, and they kept them sheltered, but they did not feed them, they did not hold them, they did not hug them, they did not kiss them, and they died. And the disease was then labeled marasmus. Now, it is no longer labeled that way because I've had occasion to look it up and I can't find it. But in those days, it was called marasmus, and I will never forget it. So I have a friend, a wonderful friend, who has an old age home, an Alzheimer home in Oakland, California. And I said, did you keep them in their rooms? And he said, sometimes you have to break a rule. He said, I'm not going to do that to my people because they absolutely, they're desperate for human connection and human touch, and I'm not going to do that. Feeding them would not be enough. They would die. And that is us. And but so I'm getting on with what else they do with the elderly. I always say that whenever I stand at a corner, everybody would be happy to help me across the street, even if I don't want to go across the street. And I'm always reminded of the time that I was in an Indian restaurant, and I said to the man, where's the ladies' room? Because at my age, you use the ladies' room approximately 40 times within a minute. But anyway, I said, where's the ladies' room? And he said, it's down some steps. And I said, well, I think I can do that. If I am brave enough to get out of the house, I believe I can manage a step, especially in London, where everything has steps. And I said, well, I think I can do that. And I started to go down the steps, and I noticed this man was right beside me. He wanted to be sure I didn't fall. And I was thinking to myself, am I going to have to take him into the booth and go into the toilet on top of him? What am I going to do? But he left me at the door of the booth and asked the cook, who was downstairs, to watch out for me to be sure I was all right. That is not helping me. That was very sweet and that was very considerate, but that is not helping me. Because the more I force myself slower and less efficiently to do all the things I need to take care of myself, the longer I will be able to take care of myself. And I think that's terribly important. I was thinking today, I live in a flat, I live in a building with a lift, and I was very upset. It's on the fifth floor, and I was very upset because one time the lift, the elevator, for those of you in America, they call elevators lifts here. I know we just think of it as something to do with your face, but they call it that. And I couldn't take the elevator up to my floor because it wasn't working, and of course nobody in this building can help me because half of them are dead. They're half dead, these people, and also at the hours I keep, they were asleep. So I had a heavy case, or it was heavy to me, to carry upstairs, and I had to carry it five flights. And I have emphysema, and if I had been seriously ill, I might have collapsed, but of course I wasn't, and I was able to do it. But it would have been, at the time, I was very angry. But when I look back, I realize, no, that was very good for me, because I need to be able to take care of myself if I'm going to expect people to treat me with the respect that I want to be treated, and and to acknowledge that I exist. Because I'm sure you've heard that the elderly all say, I'm invisible. Well, I have not had that problem. And I think I have not had that problem because I'm a loud Jewish bitch. But whatever it is, I have not allowed myself to be invisible. If I go to a store, and it has happened over and over again, if I go to a store and I and nobody pays any attention to me, I will say, excuse me, I was in line. And I make everybody else feel absolutely horrible, but it won't hurt them. But in any case, the thing I've been reading, as I've been telling you in past things, Betty Friedan's The Fountain of Age. And what I'm realizing is the more that I take advantage of the helps that are given to me as an elderly person, the less I will be able to do those acts. It's terribly important for people my age to use their brains, not to get someone else, not to get someone else to help them. When I have a challenge on the computer, it is better for me to sit and Google it until I figure out what to do, than to have somebody come over and in 3 seconds fix it. And this goes back to more. I have a feeling that in our zealousness to help people, we label people with disabilities that I'm not convinced are that serious, but you can argue with me with that. But one of the things we do is we medicate children with, in my day it was Ritalin, but now I think they have other things. They medicate children who are hyper to calm them down. And I don't believe in medication. And I would say that I had taught over 3,000 people in the 12 years that I taught, and I never had anybody that needed medication. I also never had anyone that couldn't learn to read. And I understand that they are medicating people with dyslexia. And I am saying that the most important thing you can do is learn how to live with your particular, I don't want to call it a disability, your particular ability, your particular. And I am reminded of my friend's, my cousin's wife. She was legally blind. And when I went to visit her, the kitchen, she was cooking. But the kitchen, the counter was absolutely blank. And she said, I have to know where everything is, and I have to know where to find everything. And she said, when I was younger, and she was just in her 20s, she said, when I was younger, I did the books for my mother. And I said, what do you mean? And what she was talking about was, in those days, we used to do columns of figures and add a profit and loss for businesses. And they're very tiny numbers on tiny little squares. And I said, how did you do that? Because you can't see. And she said, I taught myself. My mother refused to allow me to be blind. Bless her mother. And she said, I taught myself numbers by the shape that they were to me. And she was able to balance the books. So I'm wondering how much we contribute to our disabilities, how much we make them disabilities. I am not sure, but I do know that the more I rely on my own abilities, the more abilities I have. I know, but I can only tell you from personal experience and from those people that, as I told you, the boy that sang so beautifully. And I will leave you with a remark that Judi Dench made because it's so beautiful. She said, as we get older, we do need help. She said, but we know the help we need. We don't need excessive help. When we need help, she said, we'll ask for it. So she's talking. I was in the hospital, she said, and the nurse came up to me and leaned in so that I could hear her. And she said, I can hear perfectly well. Of course, I can't. She said, I can hear perfectly well. Leaned in so she could hear her. And she said, hello, lovey. Are you ready for lunchy-wunchy? And Judi Dench said, oh, just fuck off. And thank you so much for joining me for my thought on this Tuesday.